It with some sing-along gathering music. So I'm going to pass it over to Mark David Buckles.
Good evening, everyone. What a joy to be with you tonight. We're going to start our music tonight with a song, Come Sing a Song with Me by Carolyn McDade. It's a song that, you know, talks about bringing a rose in the wintertime. And as spring is just around the corner, and we've been thinking about this long winter of the pandemic we've been in for so long, I just think about the rose as these little gifts of sweetness and beauty that we can offer to each other in these times. So I hope you will sing a song with me. Here we go. Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Come dream a dream with me. Come dream a dream with me. Come dream a dream with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Come walk in rain with me. Come walk in rain with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me, that I might know your mind. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. And I'll bring you hope when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Thanks, everyone, and I'll turn it over to Matt for our next song.
Thank you, Mark David. I'm here with Laura, Heather, and Rebecca, my housemate family, and we love to sing together, and part of the sense of creating home that we're talking about this evening for us has to do with singing together. So we're going to share this song and invite you to sing along in your own homes.
Sing your spirit. I love hearing people singing together. Oh my gosh, it'll happen again someday for all of us. Thank you, Matt, and everybody. This is Kate Wolf. Didn't live long, but wow, what an impact in the 10 years she was a singer-songwriter. Kind friends all gather round. There's something I would say. What brings us together here has blessed us all today. Love has made a circle that holds us all inside, where strangers are as family, loneliness can't hide. You must give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter, and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Just try that tagline with me, even if you don't know the rest of the song. And give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. I've walked these mountains in the rain. I've learned to love the wind. I've been up before the sunrise to watch the day begin. I always knew I'd find you, though I never did know how. Like sunshine on a cloudy day, you stand before me now. So give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your hearts to the tears and laughter, and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Love is born in fire. It's planted like a seed. Love can't give you everything, but it gives you what you need. Love comes when you're ready. It comes when you're afraid. It'll be your greatest teacher, the best friend you have made. So give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your hearts to the tears and laughter, and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. If love is what you're after, open up your heart to the tears and laughter, and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love.
Good evening, everyone. In our service, if you have a chalice handy, we invite you to light it, or just to take a deep breath and get a little deeper into our worship together. These are the words of the Reverend Leslie Takahashi. All that we have ever loved and all that we have ever been stands with us on the brink of all that we aspire to create. A deeper peace, a larger love, a more embracing hope, a deeper joy in this life we share.
Thank you, Michael. Oh, again, welcome to Sanctuary Boston. My name is Joe, or Joanna, and I worked with Matt to coordinate this week's service. I'm the Worship Arts Lead for Sanctuary Boston. Few piece of logistics, a reminder again that we are recording, so if you would like your face not shown on YouTube later, you can turn your video off at any time. But we encourage you, if you feel comfortable with it, keep your video on so that we can see each other. We recommend to that extent gallery view if you want the crowd feeling of getting to see people sing along and pay attention together. On updated versions of Zoom, you can even drag and drop. Last time I was on a group call, I usually put the babies and the pets up front. This time I organized it by the color of people's walls so that I could feel like they were in the same rooms together. It's actually really sweet. And I invite you, you know, so many of us are now in our homes, and there's, given our theme today of homemade and understanding and reimagining home, there's something really sweet about knowing that we are welcoming each other into our homes, sometimes our work, sometimes our play spaces. But I just thank you for letting us into your home, your space. Throughout the service, we'll stay muted unless we're leading something, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't sing along. In fact, we highly recommend singing along and adding harmonies. Don't worry about forgetting it right. Just sing for the love of it. To that end, all of the lyrics are going to be in the order of service and in the chat. The order of service will also list who's doing what if you want to learn names a little better, although thank goodness Zoom has name tags built in. I love it. It makes me happy. Throughout tonight's service, we encourage you to do what is going to be best for you, whether that's what you need to do for your body, if you need to get up and stretch, if you need to dance, to eat, to step away for a moment, or if you, what you absolutely need is to be completely rocking out visibly in front of the camera so that other people feel empowered to do the same, please do that. Seriously, take care of yourself this evening. At the end, we'll have some time for connecting in breakout rooms of social hour. And in particular, this week, we'll have a special session for younger adults, roughly 18 to 25. So when we get to the end of the service, we'll have you stay in the main room if you're in that age range. I am delighted to welcome for our reflection this evening, Jamie Dingus. Jamie has been a long time stalwart, steadfast Sanctuary Boston leader and musician. And she moved down to Huntsville, Alabama to serve our UU congregation there in the summer. And so it's so great that we're able to stay connected with her. She's down there with her dog Clementine, where they are expecting big thunderstorms this evening. So we're sending prayers for gentle weather her way, for safety and for continued power and internet. So if something goes awry, it's just the weather, but nothing will. We're so glad you're here. So just a few quick words about Sanctuary Boston. So Sanctuary Boston is a community that gathers for vibrant worship and what we hope for real connection. In these gatherings that now span the globe, which is amazing, people come from so many different backgrounds, from different religious or faith traditions or none at all. Many of us belong to or serve other congregations, and some have never set foot in a religious setting. And that's all fine. We hope that this will be accessible and moving regardless of where you come from, and that you're going to be willing to share with us about who you are and what you're bringing this evening. So I mentioned this evening's service is part of a three-part series called Homemade. And in thinking about the spirit of home, some of what's been a silver lining or a hidden blessing in having these services on Zoom is we've had a number of parent-child duos routinely join our Sanctuary Boston services, which just brings me delight. Sometimes I like to move them so they're next to each other on my screen. So for tonight and next week, we'll have a couple of family units do some of our worship elements. So I'm delighted to welcome Reverend Heather Kincannon and her mom, Sharon Kincannon. One of the ways we welcome each other at Sanctuary Boston is by reading words of welcome together. So as they read from the screen, feel free to pick a typeface that calls to you, words that call to you, and we'll say the last line all together as that comes up on our screen.
Whether you go to church on Sunday morning,
or light candles on Friday nights,
whether you've been hurt by religion,
saved by it,
or some of both,
whether you're brand new to spiritual community,
or a seasoned seeker,
whoever you are, whatever you are,
wherever you are in your journey, we welcome you.
Beautiful. Thank you, Kincannons and Seymour House. Thank you. We'll take a few moments to welcome each other by sending a message in the chat. You're welcome to say a hello to everybody in the chat. You can send a private message to somebody you do or don't know, somebody whose picture isn't up, just to say, hey, I'm so glad you're here. Hope you're doing well. Glad you could join us. We'll take about 2 minutes while Mark David gives us, and Julie, welcome, gives us some instrumental music to chat by. Call our attention back. I hope you continue to greet and welcome each other as we go in lots of different ways. But I'm going to turn it over now to Lucinda Robinson, who I invite to share a little hashtag sanctuary moment, a little testimonial related to this theme of home.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lucinda. And I'm going to share just a little bit about sanctuary values showing up in my house where I spend a ton of time these days. I've been recently doing a lot of reflecting on the past year. I think March is a meaningful month these days, and it's really been a source of comfort to me to consider and enumerate the things that have kept me afloat and helped me keep moving forward. I'm really grateful for sanctuary, which has been such a big source of comfort and containment, and attending weekly gatherings has really helped me understand how deeply I value community and communal care and really strive for it to be present in my home. I am an itinerant 20-something, and it's not always been easy recently to find that deep connection and reliance and mutual support in all of my various Craigslist departments. But I have found happily that things have kind of shifted over the past year. When the pandemic hit last March, my roommates and I quickly became really accustomed to having kind of awkward but necessary and fruitful conversations about how we can successfully live together in our tiny, tiny shared space, which we affectionately call the Hotel Elm because we live on Elm Street. We started with communal groceries as kind of a thing, but then we quickly morphed into having dinners together every night, which we had not done before. And now we cook together and cook for each other every night. I can hear my roommate, in fact, cooking dinner right now. And our plan was that she bring me dinner while I was sharing this, but it does not sound like it's done. So that will not be happening. But we each week we will check in with each other and we have a little adorable whiteboard calendar and we'll sign up for our meals. My one roommate, Morgan, always takes Fridays, which we've dubbed Fun Food Fridays. She often makes really elaborate projects like homemade tortellini or dumplings or any other pasta stuffed with yummy stuff. And the rest of us fill in the rest of the week. We have our own cooking roles. Jane often cooks meat. And she'll often roast a whole chicken. There's often a whole chicken on the grocery list. And she's really a fan of Samin Nosrat, of salt, fat, acid, heat. So she'll quote those recipes all the time. Allison never ever cooks the same thing twice. She always is trying new things, but you can be sure that every meal she cooks will have broccoli and lemon in it. Morgan, in addition to being our Fun Food Friday girl, she identifies as our trash cook, which means that she has this incredible knack for reaching into the fridge, pulling out anything that's about to go bad, and making it into a delicious meal. And for myself, I am always kind of the cleanse cook. If we've been having a lot of meat and cheese, I'll come along and do some roasted vegetables, some tahini sauce, that kind of stuff. We've also really committed to our broader community. We've gotten a weekly CSA and we live for Wednesdays when we get the email with what's going to be in it and Thursdays when we actually get the box and can kind of unveil it one vegetable at a time and start meal prepping and thinking about what we're going to do with a butternut squash or a sweet potato or some. We get a ton of unidentifiable white root vegetables that we don't know what to do with, but always imagine and turn into something. And perhaps my favorite part of the meal is that we always sit down and we give a demonstration about what we're going to eat that night. And often we're having some elaborate meal with wraps and sauces. And so it necessitates some instruction on how we put it together, but it's become such a part of our days that we also demonstrate pasta and spaghetti sauce and show each other how to make, you know, a plate of noodles, how to assemble it on our plate. I think it's been interesting reflecting on this because I still sometimes, if I smell something cooking, there's a moment where I'm like, oh, that smells good. And then I realize, oh, it's for me too. Or I'll get a text, you know, that dinner is going to be at 7:15 or whatever time. And I think it's taken me a little while to get used to this idea that others are taking care of me and I'm repaying the favor when I can and when I'm able to. And it has made me see how sanctuary is really weaving in and out of my home life as well. I was talking to Matt recently and just talking about the idea that we all, we care for each other when we're able and we take care when we need it. And that's really what is happening in our home on a day-to-day basis. We've got, you know, we really seamlessly plan around the weeks when one or more of us are really slammed and graciously accept takeout or Annie's mac and cheese nights when they have to happen. But the point is that we're sitting together at the end of the day and that we're caring for each other at the Hotel Elm. And it's been a wonderful thing this year and has really helped me feel that those values of community and communal care are really present in my home and have helped keep me afloat through this year. So yeah, thank you all. I hope you all are having a wonderful dinner at your own homes tonight.
Thank you, Lucinda. It's both heartwarming and hungry making. So thank you. That's great. Our centering song this evening is from the duo Ma Muse. It's a song that's dear to my heart, We Shall Be Known. And it talks about the great turning. And it's a term that I just love, and I realized we hadn't really defined, no matter how many times we've sung it. So it's from the writer and activist Joanna Macy. And the great turning is our shift toward a more life-sustaining future for all of us. It's the vision, action, and commitment to a world in which all can thrive. I feel like that's something I can get behind. I invite you to join in singing.
We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now. And what a time to be alive. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead with love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now. And what a time to be alive. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead with love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead with love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead with love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead with love.
I spent the afternoon today on my porch. Actually, I spend most every afternoon on that back porch, except for maybe the ones that have tornadoes, but we're not gonna think about that. I sit in the waning sunlight while ladybugs flit by and land on my cafe table, crawling up the side of my laptop screen. I check my emails while sunflowers grow in the back garden. I listen to the red-headed woodpecker knock on the tall pine trees covered in lichen. I watch with amazement at this thick, muscular pit bull that can, by some miracle beyond my understanding of gravity, climb straight up the chain-link fence in between my neighbor's yards. I used to think of porches not as places themselves, but as the in-between place. A porch is where you pass by, between where you were and where you want to be. They're the quick stop to change out of muddy shoes, the little refuge where you can duck away for a private conversation before coming back inside. They're the meeting place for unplanned greetings, the doorway opened just far enough to grab the Chinese food containers. Porches were supposed to be the threshold, not the hearth. What changes in us when the purpose of our places change? As I sit on my porch, I peer through my screen, its own kind of threshold, and all day long I see into people's living rooms. I see the bookcases lovingly organized by color, the little knickknacks adorning the shelves. I see dishes and coffee cups from breakfast not yet cleaned up, a black and white wedding photos on the wall above the sofa. And in these living rooms, I see in what used to be the hearth, a threshold that I am not allowed to cross right now. And so I bring a comfier chair outside and I run an extension cord to charge my laptop and I decide to make this porch my home for a little while longer. And I ask again, what changes in us when the purpose of our places change? I think for a time at least, the change throws us off our balance. Where we used to know the rules, know who and where and how we belonged, the answer becomes less clear, less spacious. We move with hesitation into these new spaces. And we've all had to wrestle with this change. The purpose of your places, the role of your porch or your living room or your weird, awkward side hallway, or that one central table that all your roommates share, all changing and finding a new role in your life. It's been hard to adjust to. I'll share for me that this year has been, by every measure I can think of, the hardest of my life. I moved 1,300 miles south and a time zone west to start over in Huntsville, Alabama. I moved from Boston to start a new ministry that I deeply love. I don't think any of my congregants are here, but if you see this, it's a ministry that I deeply love. And also, it's been a challenge. And quickly, I've realized that I actually have two jobs. One, to do this ministry, and the other is to build myself a new home. Maybe you've had to do that too. Maybe you've had to leave a home that someone else made for you, or a home you spent time and energy and love building and you had to start over. We are constantly building new homes as we navigate relationships and community. And the truth for me is, I had to leave a really well-made home to come down here. It was a home I'd spent years building, filled with friends and roommates and community. It was cozy and comfortable. There was music and food and this energy that made me feel alive. I was surrounded by people who were creative and interesting, who always seemed so much cooler than I ever thought I was, and they all shared my values. And in the streets and on the buses and in the coffee shops and bars, everywhere I looked, I saw even more people who could be part of my community if I let them. I was open to it. I wanted a life filled with people who cared about their neighbors and made a difference in the world. And that's what I had. And then when the pandemic began for all of us, the world changed. And the homes, the communities we'd built for ourselves shrunk because they had to. Many of the living rooms, the hearths that had entertained our friends and partners, were replaced by masked porch visits or visible only through the threshold of a screen. Where once we might have danced through the doorways, we instead dodged and distanced. How did it feel then? How does it feel now to have the purposes of your places so deeply changed, to have thresholds where there used to be hearths? Despite the way my home shrunk, there were still all these memories that lived in the places of this old home. I still understood the purpose of these places. I could see the possibility in the people who could so easily become community if only I let them. And I felt rooted and sure. And now here, somewhere different and new, I don't feel rooted yet. I'm still off balance. It's really okay if you still feel off balance too. I look around this living room that's never been full of dancing loved ones, and I see a dining table with four chairs, even though I've only ever used two of them. And when I pass the stores and bars and coffee shops, none of the places have memories attached to them yet. And when I see the people on the streets, always without their masks on, I don't see those cool, creative folks who share my values in the same way. But on the brightest days, the days when I feel most hopeful and most able to take on the task of this second job, the work of building a new home for myself, I remember that the places we turn into home are always changing. I remember that beautiful things can happen on the porch or in the living room. I remember that our task is to build home for ourselves out of whatever materials present themselves. And I also remember that it's unfair to expect to have the exact same life in a new home as you're making it. I remember too that the world is more abundantly filled with people who could be our community if only we would let them in. It was a hard lesson for me, but apparently I am capable of being friends with people who are not UU ministers who wear cool jumpsuits and come to sanctuary. Who would have guessed it? Yes, a truth that I'm learning is that we can want the same things over and over again in our lives, and we can find those things in new people and new places. I wanted a life filled with people who cared about their neighbors and made a difference in the world. And though it's been harder to build, I'm starting to believe that they are here too. That I can still build a home with creative people who live their values, who just do it a little differently, as NASA rocket scientists and progressive suburban military moms. The truth is now and going forward, we will all build and rebuild home. Our communities are bound to change and shift and grow. In this moment especially, our communities are bound to change and shift and grow. And as much as we are allowed to want the same things over and over again, there can be joy in learning to find those things in new people and new places. When I moved down here to Alabama, my mom came with me and she gave me the makings of a good toolbox. She pieced together an assortment of my grandfather's tools so that I would have what I needed to build. I think she was probably thinking about a bookshelf or something like that. I'd like to offer you what is in my toolbox as a new home, new community builder. A blueprint, a hammer, a level, some wood. First, a blueprint. Remember those things about the home you are leaving that you love too much to let go of. Be clear about what this new home has to have. Creative people living their values and room enough to dance in the living room. And then look around at the materials that present themselves. Sketch out a floor plan. Be open to the possibility of a new home taking shape. Second, a hammer. Find that hammer and hammer away your expectations. Hammer away the stubbornness that told you that the kind of home you want only exists with certain types of people in certain places. Hammer away the pieces of the old home that actually weren't such a good fit. Make way for new and deep community. Get a level, a long one, with a bubble that bounces around in neon yellow liquid. Carry that level with you and keep checking it. As you're building this new home, it'll help you know when everything is balanced. And finally, you're gonna need some wood. Find some really sturdy wood and a couple of ropes so you can put a swing out on that porch. Whether that porch is a threshold between your life and the world, whether it is a comfortable place to sit and rest and take in all the possibility of your new home, build it wide enough that maybe someday someone surprising will come and swing with you. Dear ones, it takes a lot of heart to build a new home. And building and rebuilding home is a lifelong part of our journey. So I say to you, be patient, be open to the possibility of finding community with new people and in all kinds of places. Don't let the changing purpose of a place throw you off your balance. Use your good tools to build the home that you need to thrive. Blessed be and amen.
Thank you, Jamie, for those words. I admit it was hard to resist launching into If I Had a Hammer after that particular tool came up. And then I want to do, if I had a level, I'd check my work-life balance in the morning. But I'll do the song that we planned, which is the great song, Crowded Table, by The High Woman. You can hold my hand when you need to let go. I can be your mountain when you're feeling valley low. I can be your street light showing you the way home. If you can hold my hand when you need to let go. I want a house with a crowded table and a place by the fire for everyone. Let us take on the world while we're young and able and bring us back together when the day's done. If you want a garden, you're gonna have to sow the seeds. Plant a little happiness, let the roots run deep. If it's love that we give, then it's love that reap. If we want a garden, we're gonna have to sow the seeds. I want a house with a crowded table and a place by the fire for everyone. Let us take on the world while we're young and able, and bring us back together when the day is done. The door is always open, your picture's on my wall. Everyone's a little broken, and everyone belongs. Yeah, everyone. I want a house with a crowded table and a place by the fire for everyone. Let us take on the world while we're young and able and bring us back together when the day is done, and bring us back together when the day is done.
Thank you so much, Mark David. It's truly a treat to see everyone singing along with such a really lovely song. This evening, Sanctuary Boston will be sharing the offering with the Food Project, an organization whose mission is to transform the food system into a more just and community engaged model, bringing people of diverse backgrounds together to learn, grow, and build a sustainable food system that is accessible to all. Founded in 1991, the Food Project works at the intersection of youth, food, and community, focusing on areas they are most deeply connected to: Boston's Dudley neighborhood and the city of Lynn. Over 120 teenagers are part of this vital work on 70 acres of urban and suburban farmland across eastern Massachusetts. For me, the Food Project is a source of hope in the food justice movement, a viable and active alternative to the current, often oppressive, violent, and unjust food system we live in. Race and class inequalities permeate throughout the food system, from production methods that harm farm workers on land and in factories, in distribution, if we think about the recent unfair burden of risk placed on grocery workers or delivery drivers, and to consumption, where many low-income neighborhoods and communities of color have systematically been deprived of access to healthy, cultural, and affordable food. The Food Project proves that there is another way by growing and selling fresh food at local markets that works for both farmers and customers, and sowing the seeds of food justice in younger generations. You may share your gift in two ways: by giving to Sanctuary Boston. You can find the links for PayPal and Venmo shared on the screen or in the chat, and you can mark your contribution as worship or offering in the memo. Thank you so much for your contributions and whatever you can give to support sustaining the spiritual and physical nourishment of others.
Hi everyone, Julie Metcalf here. Mark David and I are gonna play some Irish tunes for you. This is The Banks of Lough Gowna and Miss Monahan's. Enjoy. Thank you.
That was so great. Oh my goodness. Let's take a breath together. Friends, as joyful as it is to be in worship together, this week also marks 1 year of worshiping online for the Sanctuary Boston community. And that's a hard truth. And after a year of this pandemic, we look at the numbers, and in the United States, 537,000 people are dead. Across the world, 2.67 million. Each of these lives was real and vibrant and cut short and deeply missed. And it feels beyond our capacity, our human capacity, to fathom this kind of loss and death and grief. And I know for myself, I find that art and music help us to engage with things that are too terrible to deal with words. So this evening, Lucas Gonzalez-Milliken has put together an art piece. It's one of his classic shadow puppets and music pieces that are so beautiful and impactful. And this music is in remembrance of this year of loss and this year of hope too. So let us center in for Lucas's piece, Porches and Living Rooms.
We arrive here in community, bringing all the joys and sorrows of our complex lives with us. We invite you now to write any sorrows you are carrying in the chat box, as sorrows shared, our burdens lightened. Thank you.
is a love holding us. There is a love holding all that we love. There is a love holding all we rest in this love.
Even in the most difficult times, we also come together bringing joy, large and small. We invite you now to write any joys you're carrying in the chat box. Joys shared are joys magnified. Spirit of life and love, we are grateful for the blessing of being together, seeing one another's faces, singing together, sharing what is most important in our hearts. It's been a long year. We're tired. We have people in our lives who are dealing with illnesses and challenges, which are always difficult and can be even harder when we can't be with them. We hope that they will feel our love and our care. From a distance. We are grateful for a sense of resurgence. Both the flowers that we, the flower buds that we see every year, but also the possibility of being with some people again soon. Parents getting to hug children that they haven't seen for a long time. The road is, we still have a long road to where we can, where being together physically is commonplace. But we are grateful for the changes that are happening. And for all of the work, all of the people who work to create the vaccines, for the volunteers that are stepping forward to help vulnerable people navigate the system and receive them. And we are filled with hope. That more people will be joining us on our porches, in our time of reaching out and touching one another emotionally. May it be so, and amen.
Friends, I have decided to believe that the homes that we aspire to create are possible. They are possible built on a deeper peace, a larger love, a more embracing hope, a deeper joy. Be open to the possibility. Be patient when you feel off balance. Assemble your tools. Cross over the threshold, so that you can find all that you need to thrive. Blessed be, amen.
Thank you, Jamie. So great to have you here, back with us. Our last song for tonight is Home. And we've done this song quite a few times at Sanctuary. There are some repeating verses, so feel free to sing along, dance, whatever works for you.
Thank you, Alex, so much for that. Such wonderful music from all of our musicians.